Hi, I'm Laura Marwood, product strategist for Cloud ERP, and today I'm once again joined by ERP thought leader, Paul Saunders.
Hello, Laura.
Not a lot of people think of ERP as being particularly sexy or cool, and a lot of this AI stuff is extremely sexy and cool.
Yeah.
So why don't you paint a picture for us of what AI applications might look like in a classic ERP scenario?
Let's say I'm rushing to make a flight, and I have to approve a budget. Now, think about the intelligence that's behind all of the SAP systems here. It knows where I am, it knows who I am, it knows what my role is, it knows where I am in the process, it knows I'm at the airport. Now, through multi-experience, I might also have said, look, I've got an Android phone and I've got a Garmin watch. So instead of me having to find a place to sit down, open the laptop, log in, do all this sort of stuff, I get a notice on my Garmin watch that says, approved budget, 25,000 euros, yes or no, I can hit yes and carry on to the gate. All of the intelligence that comes behind or pulling all of this stuff together is driven by AI, BTP, Concur and Tripit and S4HANA and so on. Think of the productivity improvement that can have, you know, with everybody. And most importantly, I can feel very confident that the data that shows up on my watch and the decision it's asking me as a human to make is the right one.
And you mentioned that, you know, you could make a decision with the click of the button on your Garmin watch. That involves a lot of trust. And I know we've talked a little bit about the trust and the distrust piece. Do you think we as humans are there yet to fully consume AI to its total capacity?
At SAP, we're saying it's not just artificial intelligence. It's the artificial intelligence and the human intelligence that come together. You can say, look, here is your production plan for the next month, for the next quarter, whatever, next week, whatever it might be. And then it will start to say, here's some of the concerns that we have. And here's some decisions that the system needs you as the human to make. So it might say, we know that you maintain buffer stock of X in all of your manufacturing plants on the East Coast of the US. And that buffer stock is used for making product A and product B. We're seeing through our sales data that there's a big surge in demand for product A. The buffer stock that you have to make product A might not meet that surge. And we also see that some of the key materials for that are coming in from the West Coast, and you're sending them to a different plant. One of the recommendations that we have is make more product A, less product B, and change the shipment to go from factory A to factory B. Would you like to have more details? Would you like to make that? Or would you like to carry on with as you were? That's where I've still got to trust that this stuff, but I'm going to go and review it. Over time, we might get to the point where, you know, we're all sitting back and saying, hey, you know, Alexa, Google, whatever it might be, Siri, you know, run my business for me. But I think it's going to be long after I'm gone.
Let's talk a little bit about hypes, Paul.
Yep.
And I was just reading a Gartner article a couple of weeks ago that mentioned the metaverse and how the metaverse is now struggling, you know, with low adoption use cases.
Yep.
How do you see AI fitting into that? Is it another hype, or is there a bit more to it than what we've seen with the metaverse?
AI has been around for a long time, and it's been improving and improving and improving. Machine learning has really come on, you know, leaps and bounds. But it's not about the hype technology. It's about the outcome. We all experience AI every single day. We might just not know it. So yes, there's a hype right now. It's, you know, it's become kind of on the news. But behind the hype, AI has already shown that it can do some amazing things. We've been embedding AI into our products for a long, long time at SAP. But the potential, particularly with this, what they call generative AI,
mm-hmm.
that could change how we work, how businesses operate, how people buy, how people live, and so on. And I think that's where the concerns are, where the governance needs to be. And it just needs clearer heads to prevail, so to speak, and not get caught up in this is the dystopian future and it's going to destroy us all. I don't think that's true at all.
So, Paul, is all this AI stuff, is this just for really super techie companies, or is this something that's available to everybody out there for everybody to leverage?
Very few companies are coming and saying, hey, I want AI, you know? But what they are saying is, I would like to be able to grow my business, optimize my business, de-risk my business. I want to be able to get into new markets. I want to be able to help differentiate my product. I need to be able to help my supply chain be less fragile so that when things happen, and things always happen, that my business continues to thrive. And I want to be able to get some insight, some advice, some detail on how I can do that. AI can start to do this. AI is doing this in our systems right now, providing, you know, we've been talking about the intelligent enterprise for a long time. The intelligence is not just the human intelligence, but it's human and artificial intelligence together. So AI is not something where we say, oh, SAP is jumping on the bandwagon. Mm-hmm. We've been doing this a long time.
Mm-hmm. And what are the first things that customers then really need to ask themselves?
A lot of times with technology, we often apply it in places that it's not needed.
Right.
The thing with AI and machine learning in particular is that in business, I can't think of a place where it wouldn't add value, because it really is, there's so much information, there's so much data, there's so many data sources that right now you can only kind of make decisions based on some of them. With artificial intelligence, as you start to pull all these different things in, it can start to match the patterns. It can start to learn on what things are important and so on. It can start to say, look, not only can you, you know, this is what's going to go on with your market and your supply chain, but this is what could happen with the weather, you know? And by the way, if, you know, if your local sports team is playing at home on a Wednesday, you could sell X more of this or Y more of that, or this might impact. All of that stuff is really, really valuable. But don't start with, hey, I've got AI, what should I do with it? It's still going to be, why am I in business? Why does a customer come to me? What's the future look like for me? How do I differentiate? What am I actually trying to do? The AI is there. You know, it's how it can help you. It's not just, don't start with the technology.
In one of our other conversations, Paul, we talked about clean core, where you also explained a little bit more about this 80-20 rule and the 20% being the opportunity to really, you know, kind of differentiate. How could AI fit into that 20% piece to really help customers differentiate?
If we feel that we differentiate based on our speed of delivery, mm-hmm. you know, we get the shoes to you the next day, mm-hmm. then maybe we can start to look at AI to say, well, could we actually make that 12 hours? You know, is there a way to do this differently? Could I change how I manufacture, how I get my raw materials to this, how I do my warehousing, all these kind of things? It might be stuff that I haven't even thought of where AI could say, well, there's this idea and this idea and this idea. So that's on the 20%. Yeah. On the 80%, this is where AI sits behind the scenes and optimizes constantly. So if you say that, you know, I'm doing accounts payable, everybody has to do accounts payable. You want to be able to do it. You want to be able to do it well. AI can keep improving that process.
Fascinating to see how this conversation is going to develop, Paul. And yeah, thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you again, Laura.